We have our last external speaker of the session up next, introducing Jacob Benjamin.
Hello, and thank you all for the opportunity to talk to you about how we can use MITRE ATT&CK to create cyber DBTs for nuclear power plants. Can't change my slide. Okay. So I am Dr. Jacob Benjamin. I'm a director of professional services at the industrial cybersecurity firm Dragos. And my background is in computer science and nuclear engineering. And my research areas usually focus on the overlap of those two disciplines. So let's talk about DBT. So DBT stands for Design Basis Threat. And the concept was introduced in 1979 by the Nuclear Regulatory Commission, or the NRC. And simply put, it's an adversary profile. And it includes details about the adversary, such as the type, the composition, and their capabilities. And so nuclear power plants use DBT as the key input for designing their systems that protect them against acts of radiological sabotage or prevent the theft of special nuclear material. And so each plant will have a DBT, and the regulator, the NRC, expects them to be able to demonstrate that they can defend against that. So how are they made? Well, traditionally, DBTs are developed by analyzing credible threat intelligence and examining past nuclear security events. And so the output is a list of potential adversaries and their attributes, characteristics, possible actions they may take. And then an analysis is done that determines whether specific adversaries are relevant to that site or their targets. And ultimately, you get a specific DBT to that facility. And then the physical protection experts at that site design the system and then regularly assess it based on this DBT. And so while a site's DBT is almost always classified or restricted information, I have an example here from the International Atomic Energy Agency. And as you can see, it describes the threat as a team of people, like six people here, and they're attempting to steal some plutonium. And so it includes specific details about the targets and their capabilities, right? And so this information is then used by the physical protection experts to design the defense systems. So for example, this DBT lets us know that the physical barriers there need to withstand 10 kilograms of TNT explosive. And so that's really useful information for designing your physical protection system. And so after designing the defenses, physical security experts will regularly assess them. And so an assessment of the defenses comes down to a function of time. So specifically response time versus adversary time. And so they have sensors, and those are usually categorized in terms of their performance and detection probability or false alarm rate. You also have barriers such as fences, walls, and doors, and those are characterized in terms of delay or the time it takes an adversary to overcome them, right? And so the goal of the system designer is to interweave detection and delay measures in such a way that it allows the reaction force to interrupt and neutralize the adversary before they get to their the goal within that designated timeframe. And so this approach allows physical protection systems, allows the experts to predict, control, and like quantify the performance of their defenses, right? And so we can and should use these same principles with cyber. And so, well, what about cyber DBTs? Well, this approach wasn't done for cyber. So in 2002, when cyber was added to the long list of threat actor capabilities that plants need to consider when developing their DBTs, they opted to not use it. So instead of doing that, they decided to address cybersecurity through the application of prescribed cybersecurity controls. So this is like the NIST 800. They changed them, and I've got them on the slide here, the ones they specifically used. But it should be known that that there's no research has ever been done that really shows that compliance-based approaches like this have had an effect on actual safety or security issues. And sorry, lost my place there. Okay, so the unfortunate reality here is that this compliance-based approach has left plants unable to quantify the effectiveness of their cyber protective measures, right? And so, and I'm talking about specifically like how they would go up against a TTP of an adversary in a cyber manner, right? So they can only determine compliance, not security. I postulate that they chose this approach due to the following three challenges, right? And so, these are challenges that I believe using MITRE ATT&CK can help you overcome. So the first of which is the rapid evolution of the cyber threat landscape. And this is, you know, it's constantly changing. And so the ability to describe it accurately and update it on a regular basis is difficult. The second being the modeling software that they use for this usually focuses on equipment failures. And so that results in inaccurate modeling of cyber-initiated events. And then third, there's also this concept of maloperation, right? And so for power plants, maloperation of a system is often a worse outcome than commodity malware. And so we most notably saw this with the Ukraine events in 2015, where adversaries gained access to operational systems and then opened the breakers to cause an outage, right? So as a threat behavior lexicon there, ATT&CK can help us accurately describe the landscape. It can help with adversary emulations, like some of the other speakers today talked about, as well as it can help us study and evaluate past events and their relevance to us, right? And these are all steps that we need to do in traditional DBT analysis. And so we can use these, we can use the power of ATT&CK with these three inputs of past cyber events and intelligence and our site-specific targets to get an output that's detailed and has quantitative data that can be compared against our defenses, right? And it's going to be specific to our facility or the adversary actions against our facility. So for past events, we may look to things that have happened in the nuclear sector or the energy sector overall. We can also expand to other sectors if desired, right? And so for threat intelligence, there's lots of sources for that. You can get it from CISA or threat intelligence firms such as Dragos, as well as notifications from your system vendors or OEMs. They oftentimes send notifications as well. And then the last part there, but definitely not the least, is we have to have an understanding of our systems and their value as potential targets to adversaries. So what are our high consequence events and what are the pathways that lead to them? And so I have a quick example that we can walk through. Okay, so we have targets at our facility. We've got a safety instrumentation system, we've got turbines, we've got backup generators, right? And so now we have to ask relevant questions like what past events have happened in our vertical or that involve these systems, who targets our industry, what kind of systems or the kinds of systems that we have. And if they do target our systems, what weapons or TTPs would they use against them, right? And so this one's pretty easy to pick out. I've got some samples there. So we have a safety instrumentation system or a SIS, and that was targeted by Xenotime in 2017 with they developed the Trisys malware that was specifically designed to ATT&CK that, right? And so we can use our intelligence feeds to get TTPs that Xenotime uses. So let's see if we can put that all together and create a cyber DBT like the example one, but for cyber. And so this cyber DBT gives us actionable items for defense requirements. It highlights the likely targets, in this case, a SIS, and its high consequence event, the loss of safety, right? It includes known behavior of the adversary's TTPs. It also informs us of their sophistication or their intent. It lets us know that they understand ICS and they want to cause harm, right? And so there's a little bit here about insider, and this lets us know that we don't have to focus on an active insider. And I'm not saying we shouldn't defend against the active insider. I'm just saying that Xenotime hasn't been observed compromising insiders in their attacks. And so it might be something we prioritize later, right? And so using threat intelligence, we can obtain a list of Xenotime TTPs. And because they are described in ATT&CK, it's easy to identify their associated mitigations, right? And so for here, we have 14 of them for 5 TTPs. And usually resources are limited, so we may need to prioritize some of these over others. As we have some mitigations that cover multiple TTPs, it makes sense to take a look at those first. So with that mindset, we can get an initial coverage of Xenotime if we implement 3 mitigations: multi-factor authentication, antivirus, and restricting web-based content. However, we probably wouldn't stop there. Like, we would likely want to have some mitigation overlap, especially with an adversary as sophisticated as Xenotime. And so it makes sense to add additional mitigation layers with limit access to resource over the network, M1035, and network segmentation, M1030, as those also cover multiple TTPs. And network segmentation tends to be the number one recommendation from our services team, as well as in CISA reports. And so we would just continue to add these mitigations as we could until we're satisfied with our coverage or our risk level. And so this slide has just a diagram that's showing the coverage of the mitigation over the TTPs. So using ATT&CK can also help us with our measuring our detection capabilities. And so here you can see I've broken down Trisys, the malware that Xenotime used in their safety instrumentation ATT&CK, by its threat behaviors. And so I have used a mixture of enterprise ATT&CK and ATT&CK for ICS, but that's because safety instrumentation system is ICS. So it's going to have behaviors of both there, right? And so you can see we're going to focus on scripting T853. And that's because Trisys used a compiled Python script, right? And so we don't want to just detect that specific Python file or Python scripts in general, but all of scripting. So this helps us if Xenotime switched to PowerShell or to Visual Basic, right? And so this ensures that we have resilient detections based on threat behavior and not simply indicators. And so as I start to wrap up, I just want to clarify that, you know, cyber DBTs, you know, you can now use a traditional process, right? That we couldn't use before. Like MITRE ATT&CK enables us to use that known traditionally good process, but for cyber. It really helps us correlate those disparate data sources into a way that we can really understand. And we focus on the threat behaviors to correlate things from our systems and our intelligence, as well as past events, right? So why should you use DBTs or cyber DBTs for your area, right? And so cyber DBTs can measure the effectiveness of the mitigations and detections in the terms of the threat behaviors that they detect or address. Instead of simply saying, hey, we're compliant with this regulation, we can actually have some kind of measurable data. Cyber DBTs can be used to develop and test incident response playbooks. And then these scenarios are more realistic for that facility and likely result in more meaningful drill or exercise when they're conducted. And that's inevitably going to result in better trained personnel from like a training perspective, better prepared, right? And lastly, DBTs allow defenders to properly scope their defenses. Like, so with the current approach, cyber is unbounded. And what I mean by that is that plants are required to defend against all adversaries, regardless of their sophistication or state sponsorship. And so having a DBT can help plants, or having a DBT specific for cyber can help plants identify when they're in like a beyond design scenario, and they can call in support from CISA, the FBI, or incident response firms. And so as I'm talking about, like in the beginning with the six folks and the guns, like if they show up with a tank, that's beyond my design scenario. And I'm gonna need to know that I need to call backup. And we need to have the same thing with cyber, because it's unfair to say, hey, you have to keep out all of the X-Men, right? Like that's like an impossible thing. And so with that, I'm down to questions, and hopefully you've got some good ones for me, Jamie.
Yeah, excellent presentation. And first off, I love the Twitter name. I was like, immediately know what you're talking about. So that's fantastic. Actually, I'm going to borrow one of the questions from the Q&A. It's actually a really great question is, you know, as cyber practitioners, we know that, you know, ICS, nuclear, all these are different environments, and a lot of the same security paradigms carry over, as you said, even the attack framework. You know, we can, there's a lot of ideas that we can just kind of apply to this domain, but also there's a big learning curve in terms of exactly everything you talked about. That's non-traditional for a lot of folks. So what is kind of your best advice for, you know, bring people up to speed? And even if you're talking to like a CISO or something like that at a higher level, how do you kind of get them in the right mindset where they're able to understand, you know, traditional security approaches that we have might not directly apply, but there's, you know, additional things exactly as you outlined that we can do in this space?
Yeah, I think the big thing there is exactly what the attack encyclopedia brings to the world, right? It gives us a common language to talk to CISOs and to talk to, we can use that same language when we're talking to CISOs as well as the system engineer. And so we can look at that impact column of the attack and use that to find the high consequence scenarios when we're talking to a process engineer. And then that is like more definable. It's not saying, hey, we got, we're domain admin on this network. No, it's like, what can you do with domain admin? Oh, I can cause like a loss of safety because I can now send unauthenticated commands directly to your PLC or your controller, right? And so when we can get that language and we can speak it so that everyone's understanding, it's really important, right? And so then we can focus on the right problems and prioritize them. So yeah, just having that common language is really important. And then yeah, there's so much information out there from all these different sources. So being able to bring them together using ATT&CK is really powerful.
Yep. Excellent. Thanks. Yeah, definitely. I think we're just hit our time, but definitely hop over to Slack and answer any questions and responses there. But thanks again for your time.
Thank you for having me.